debate post dissertation. We've given him about 20 minutes to do his presentation. Goes over, it's okay. You'll have about 10 minutes afterwards for open discussion. We do ask that you wait until after his presentation to ask any questions you might have. And then once the questions start to kind of die down or we hit that 10-minute mark, we'll go ahead and dismiss you, and then he'll have a conference with his committee members. So if we'll go ahead and give our attention to Jay.
Well, welcome, everyone. I'm Jay Host. I want to invite everyone. Thank you. Also want to thank my committee members for coming. Especially want to thank Dr. Zoll for helping me every single week through this process. As I've gone through this journey for my dissertation. So my dissertation topic is perceptions of outdoor leaders towards their spirituality in the natural environment, the Q method inquiry. And so a little bit of background. We have a trend now in society where people are spending less time in the outdoors and more time with their electronics. And so for outdoor recreation, kind of finding a way to promote outdoor recreation to as many people as possible, we might need to look at some of the benefits, some of the aspects that people can get from outdoor recreation, such as outdoor spirituality. And so a few of the terms that we're going to be talking about, we have outdoor recreation. Outdoor recreation is those activities that are in and for the outdoors themselves. They are looking at participating in an activity that has that interaction with the natural environment, with nature, with the outdoors. So then with outdoor recreation, we have outdoor leaders. Now, outdoor leaders come as the designated person who is in charge of the activity that has legal and moral responsibility to help the group members stay safe and protect the environment during that outdoor recreation experience. And so these leaders are usually helping people who are not necessarily very familiar with that activity or that setting, or helping people who want to take an activity that might be a little bit above their skill level. Then as we look at outdoor spirituality is that connectedness to a higher power, being a God, nature, Mother Nature, or just connectedness to other people. And it's also the search for life's meaning and understanding of a greater or ultimate reality while being in the outdoors. And so that's going to be the overarching definition for outdoor recreation or outdoor spirituality. Now, our last background term is going to be about spiritual intelligence. And this is going to be part of my theoretical framework that will help me with my methodology. And so, just a little bit of background, this is going to be concerned with the inner life of mind and spirit, and then its relationship with being in the world. It's a person's capacity to have those deep understanding of existential questions, those questions that really don't have a 100% answer, but what we can glean from what might be true for them. It also is about the emergence of that deepening awareness of matter, life, body, mind, soul, and spirit. So my statement for the problem is there's kind of limited literature about outdoor spirituality, especially for how outdoor leaders perceive what outdoor spirituality is and how it relates to that phenomenon. And so my purpose is to look at that phenomenon from the perspective of outdoor leaders. And we're also going to look at what are some of those differences that outdoor leaders see for this phenomenon. And I only have one question that I'm going for this research, and that was outdoor leaders' perceptions about outdoor spirituality. So kind of going back to the spiritual intelligence, I'm looking at spiritual intelligence as my framework that I'm going to have. And again, just to recap, it's about looking for something that's bigger than yourself. It's processing those unanswerable questions, and it's making sense of life. And this is part of the multiple intelligence theory, where we have linguistics and kinesthetic intelligence, mathematical intelligence. There's a lot of different intelligence out there. So this is the capacity to be able to take on kind of that spiritual realm. Now, Mangrani, she came up with several key aspects that go along with spiritual intelligence. And those are really what I'm going to use as my filter through my methodology: self-awareness, personal power, the spiritual exercise and health, religiosity, love, values and integrity, and then also interpersonal relations and helping behavior. And so as we continue on into the research design, I use Q methodology. And for Q methodology, I'm looking at the subjective, that first person viewpoint. And so it's going to be an abduction for this. And I'm looking at what can we take from this as a new explanation or new insight into the phenomenon. It's also going to be not a generalization. I'm not testing or verifying any theories. We're just looking at what do outdoor leaders perceive of this phenomenon of outdoor spirituality. I have a concourse that's kind of the beginning, the foundation of all of this, and that's going to be pretty much everything that I can learn about outdoor spirituality. I was looking at it from the transcendentalists, I was looking at it through several writers from outdoor recreation, also from nature, and also kind of bringing in some thoughts from spiritual intelligence to kind of help out with how can this be looked at. Now, that's a lot of information, so I need to filter that down, and that's where I use that theoretical foundation of spiritual intelligence and using those key aspects. And I was able to take all those thoughts and kind of categorize them with each of those key aspects. And with that, I totally forgot to give you guys the handouts. But anyways, with that, each of those statements kind of went in there, and if there's any that were duplicates, I kind of combined those together. If anything was kind of unclear, kind of took those out, and it was allowed to have 5 to 7 statements per key aspect, which came out to 42 statements. And that was my cue set. That's the statements that the participants are going to go through. And now, my participants, or the P set for Q method, is that purposeful sample. I'm going to find outdoor leaders that can really help me with this. And these outdoor leaders I knew from conferences, workshops, past work experiences. And I want to ask them, what do they think? But I don't want to be biased on this and only people that I know. So I ask them, who else do you know that's an outdoor leader that may sort this differently than you would? So it's broadening that view. So I had 13 that were part of my purposeful sample. Then I had 17 that were outside of that snowball as it kept on building and building. And I went around the country, and I had 30 outdoor leaders for this, and I went 5,000 miles to go talk with them, a trip that I highly recommend that everyone takes. Now, of those outdoor leaders, we have quite a bit of variety. I did collect some demographic data from them: their sex, their age, the type of organizations that they worked for, how many years were they an outdoor leader, and then their longest trip that they were in the outdoors, being a participant or a leader. Maybe that kind of had a little bit of a play into it. And then their religious affiliation. So I collected all that. Now, for the methodology itself, they needed to be able to organize it. And this is going to be on a Q-sort board, and they're able to align their statements along here. And there's only one question: what was your experience in nature as they're sorting these? Now, as they're going through this, that we started off with the information about study, so there was no signature as a consent form, as they read the purpose and knowing what's going to happen, by participating, they're giving consent. And then I give them the 42 statements, and they read through them, and they start putting them into three piles. A pile, well, I like this statement, I've experienced that. Be another pile, I don't necessarily like that statement, or I haven't experienced it. Maybe a neutral one to where they don't know where it should go, or they may not even understand what the statement is. They kind of put that in the middle. Now, from those three statements, they start to rank order. So I have them first start putting statements right here, the two most extreme statements for them. What do they like the best? What really fits them? And they place that in the plus five. And then they put that pile down, and then they go to the opposite side of what would be the two statements that are the least like them. What do they least like out of all those? And they put that in the negative five. And then they come back to the positive four and then the negative four. And they work their way towards the middle. That way they're able to put some more emphasis on those extremes, because that's where we're going to find the meat of this study, is what do they really, really like about it? What's in the middle doesn't necessarily have as much weight when we get to the statistical analysis. And then, of course, they do the demographic survey, which kind of showed you how that broke down for them. Now, the data analysis, I entered in all those Q sorts that they did into PQ method software. And that software is specifically made for Q method. And from there, I did a principal component factor analysis and a Baremax rotation to where I was able to find where were some of these differences. How did people line up in there, and how did they make these groupings together? And three factors emerged from that, a three-factor solution. Now, I have a correlation table there, and as you can see, factors one and three didn't really have a whole lot together. Factors two and three didn't really have a whole lot together, but if we look at factors one and three, it has 0.5. That may be something we want to talk about later on. Now, we also, with this analysis, were able to see which sorters aligned with which factors. And so we had about 7 to 8 sorters per factor as they line up there. But then we also had several sorters that didn't necessarily line up with them. Either they didn't have any significance for any of the factors, or they were confounded, meaning that they were significant for multiple factors, and they kind of muddy up a little bit of the views there. And so they weren't necessarily utilized during later on in my analysis. But those individuals who really lined up with a particular factor, they're the ones that I want to get more information from. And so I did a post-sort interview with three individuals, one individual for factor one, factor two, and one for factor three. And I was able to ask them, what did they mean about this statement that was significant about that factor? And so with that, I was able to do a thematic analysis and looking at what their answers were, how did each of these factors line up? And I came up with three themes for each of these. The first factor I would call the sense of transcending. And the sense of transcending had two sub-themes that went with them, betterment and improvement, and then also connection. And so when we look at the betterment and improvement, we could see which statements were significant for that. Now, the exemplar sorter for that one, he says, the outdoor leader may look to nature to teach, heal, and rejuvenate oneself. This is the place where he feels the most like himself. So that was his sense for these statements. And then for connection, he said it puts perspective as our place as humans in nature. Humans are not separate from nature. I can see how we're no better than any other life form. We are equal as life forms. And so he really saw himself as being a part of nature. and that was really important to them. But when we go to the next factor, we had a sense of God, a higher power, and fellowship. And that first one, the exemplar sorter, he says, and he quotes, on the AT trail, Appalachian Trail, you can walk for hours and not talk to anyone. This is when I feel like I can hear God the most, he says. He elaborates later on that the distractions of society drowns out the voice of God, and that's why he goes to nature. So God is a very important part of his experiences when he goes into nature during outdoor recreation experiences. But then also, there's the sense of fellowship as part of it. Now, none of these statements ended up being statistically significant from the analysis, but they did have relevance because, look, one of them was a +5, a +4, a +3. Those are pretty high on those sorts. Now, he says that for this, nature brings forth conversation of faith and the questions of life. While some may not be open to new viewpoints, many appreciate the trust and openness amongst their travel companions. And so going to the outdoors really bonds people together. They're able to talk about some pretty serious stuff, those existential questions, what is the meaning of life, so on and so forth. Now, the last of the factors that emerge, we had the sense of challenge. And the sense of challenge really looked at two aspects. We had the challenge of social norms and the challenge of self. Now, this sorter, he said, for challenging the social norms, communing with nature can give freedom outside the man-made churches, temples, mosques, and cathedrals. It also gives freedom to worship alone. I feel most spiritual while being alone and in untainted settings. It is where I can connect to myself and the area around me. So challenging that norm of you had to go with a more organized way to experience spirituality. There's also challenging the self, and with that, he's challenging those self-imposed norms. While traveling through the outdoors on my own physical effort, there's a testing of my abilities and weaknesses. It's crucial to know one's limitations and strengths. As an outdoor leader, you need to be able to depend on your own strengths and not be blindsided by your weaknesses, because that could cause some issues later on. Now, the last thing that really came out of that analysis was one particular statement. Statement number 30 looked at wilderness as a necessity. Now, all three factors had that one as being significant. And all three of the individuals kind of told me what they thought about that. They thought it's a place to escape from the material and social world. It's a place to reconnect to nature. You can prioritize what is important in your life when you're in the outdoors. It evaluates one's life and also recreates the self. So wilderness is a very important place. Now, that's what they said here, but maybe there could be a little bit of an influence of these individuals picked their career of being in the outdoors. Maybe that could have some play of why it's so important. Now, during the discussion for this, a few things kind of came up. We were looking at that correlation table earlier, and factors 1 and 3 kind of had that 0.5 correlation, and that may be part of age and experience, because both of them were dealing with the self as part of it. And so the younger and less experienced individuals, they seem to align a little bit more with factor 3, the challenging the social norms, the challenging self. And so they're probably in that stage of life where they are kind of breaking out on their own and really getting to know themselves. But then the older, more experienced outdoor leaders who were aligned a little bit more with factor 1, they were, you know, looking at that inner self and becoming more of that whole person, maybe even Maslow's hierarchy of needs of extending to a higher level for it. Now, remember, this is not supposed to be for generalizations. This was just within this group of leaders. So we can't necessarily say, oh, well, all outdoor leaders, the older you get, this will happen. Now, also, when we looked at factor two, everyone that was a part of that identified as being Christian. Even though there are a few Christians that were in factor one and three, factor two was solely only Christians. And there's probably that importance of God is really important to them and putting that faith into it. And so we want to note that that could have a huge influence for them. Now, implications for this, we have, we need to help focus more for outdoor recreation to include outdoor spirituality. This could be promoting the benefit of outdoor spirituality as part of the experience, you know, bringing it into our program, but also maybe even marketing outdoor spirituality as a spiritual journey during our recreation experiences. Then we also probably need to provide more training to our outdoor leaders. And this could be from providing, you know, more of a definition for them, providing explanations of how can this be viewed by multiple people, which this study shows three particular views. Also, we need to help them understand their own comfort level with outdoor spirituality. And if they don't necessarily feel very comfortable with this topic, maybe a mentorship program to where they get with another outdoor leader and kind of learn from them and help them mature for this topic. And that could later on help them, will help their participants later on for their maturity. Now, future research, we can replicate this study and look at outdoor leaders with different religious backgrounds. We didn't have any outdoor leaders that were Muslim, Buddhist, Hindu, Shinto, Native American in any of their identification of being spiritual. And so that might bring some new insights to this phenomenon. Also, we could also have some replication of the perceptions of participants in outdoor recreation experiences. Because there's definitely a lot more participants than there are of outdoor leaders, and they may experience something totally different. So looking at those insights. And then also for our future research, we could look at exploring more on the transference of beliefs from the outdoor leader to the participant themselves. Is there any transference? Because maybe the outdoor leader is influential for those participants. And then also, what influences spiritual intelligence and the maturity of that for outdoor leaders and participants? Is the setting influential? You know, a desert setting versus a mountain versus the ocean? Or is the type of activity an influence? Backpacking, whitewater rafting, bird watching. Or maybe is the participants that they're going with in their backgrounds, would that be an influence? Also, maybe an exploration of best practices of how to bring outdoor spirituality into our programs to help develop our leaders and our participants. So looking at but also, maybe we could look at the barriers of why would outdoor leaders not incorporate outdoor spirituality. So what would be positive for us to do, but what might be those roadblocks to prevent it? So to conclude, I just want to say that outdoor spirituality has been identified by these outdoor leaders as being deeply personal experiences. Now, for each individual, they had their way that they viewed it. But just in general, there is no one or best way of looking at outdoor spirituality as a whole, because it really is that personal experience. And we had three factors that really emerged from this. The sense of transcending, the sense of God, higher power, and fellowship, and also the sense of challenge. So as we continue on in looking at this phenomenon, hopefully our base and keep on going, finding more about this phenomenon. Does anyone have any questions? Curtis.
You're talking about, I know it was the pre-sense of challenge, it was the sense of challenge slide right before. You were talking about how a gentleman had, it wasn't significant, but he had high numbers of 5 and 4 on his answer. And I'm just trying to understand why that's still important if it's not significant, even though it's a high numbers.
So as we look at a Q sort board, for each factor, a statement kind of aligns in there. Now, some of those statements ended up being statistically significant because lots of people would have put it at that exact location. Now, even though some of those statements, we had a 5, we had a 4, we had a 3, maybe people didn't put them exactly in that place, but kind of for that whole entire factor, that was the average place where they kind of put it. And so it still had some meaning, even though it wasn't statistically, it should be right exactly there.
What was your criteria for determining an outdoor leader?
An outdoor leader is someone who identifies themselves as an outdoor leader and has worked at least one season as an outdoor leader, and that they're over 18, given these for the IRB for them. And the majority of them had definitely worked a lot more than just one season. And starting off with my purposeful sample, these are individuals that I've definitely known have been in the field for quite a while.
I guess to go along with that, when you say an outdoor leader, though, are they Knowles instructors? Are they camp counselors? Are they?
It's how they identify themselves as being an outdoor leader. But I did talk to people who were part of Outward Bound, people who were part of military recreation, people who worked for outdoor programs in city parks and rec, for universities that had their own private guide services. So I kind of tried to get people from all over the place. Versus, well, I've worked here, and I'm just going to kind of ask these people.
Piggybacking on those questions, well, first off, great job. great hard work on both ends, for sure. When you talk about the outdoor leader as well, were they all current outdoor leaders, or was there kind of thinking about the criteria, were they current, or was they, could they have been, could they have exited the field for the past year or two and still have
that wasn't necessarily part of the criteria that we used. Everyone that was part of this piece set was current, except for two that were professors, and they hadn't necessarily led any trips for a while, but they are still kind of the educators or outdoor leaders. But everyone else was working in the field. But initially, that was not necessarily a criteria.
Last question. You talked about how age might have played a factor into the perspectives. Did you have an actual age range? I'm just curious as to maybe the youngest to an oldest. I remember seeing it, but I didn't get that.
Yeah. So I had a few that were, you know, quite young. We had some 18, 19, 20-year-old, or actually I think the youngest was 20 years old.
19.
Oh yeah, so we did have some that were a little bit younger, and then we had some that were much older, and it just happened to be that more of the younger people aligned with that factor 3, and some of the more older, more experienced people aligned with that factor 1.
Could you, so like the middle range, I guess, did they align more specifically with a certain perspective, or did you...
They had some overlap in those ages as well, but again, this wasn't necessarily generalizing for that, so I wasn't looking too deeply into the specific ages and where they were. It's just kind of their averages. Well, these were the younger, these were the older.
Thanks.
Going along with age, you made a comment about younger participants more of a not wanting to conform to the norm. How would you expect as that 22-year-old turns 40? What are your thoughts? I mean, is there any, will their thoughts change? Will their, any thoughts on that? This is more asking you personally.
For me personally, people kind of, you know, they're a little bit more rebellious when they're younger, and then maybe they do start to conform, or maybe their rebelliousness kind of conforms society itself, and so it kind of slowly changes as well, even though as a 40-year-old, they're probably not going to be as radical as maybe they were in their 20s. And that would be very interesting to look at the future of how does these views change from when you were younger, you get a little bit older, you get a little bit older. Does that maturity within that spiritual intelligence really play out? But that would be a good future study.
I'm just going to ask you, I know you said recommendations and stuff like that, but now that you've done this and wherever you go off to, what's your next step with what you have here with your research? What is your next step?
I think I would like to really focus on the influences of spiritual intelligence and the alpha leader and participant. I've seen, does different things kind of influence that? Or, because of what they like to do, would that be more of an influence of it? Not necessarily the setting or the activity, but where they are. So I looked at several different theories, and this one just kind of really aligned the most with it versus looking at mindfulness, because mindfulness was kind of the other theory that I was kind of leaning towards. This one just kind of really fit into place a lot more, and it kind of had some, its framework gave me that filter a lot easier. Mindfulness was a little bit more wide open as a topic, you know. And for me, it was just going to be a little bit more difficult. So I tried to keep it somewhat simple for myself.
And some may argue that snowballing is really not a great technique to use. And you and I've had this discussion, but why is snowballing important for Q methodology?
Well, Q methodology really has a lot of that purposeful sampling. So then you know that you're able to get some point of views, and you're trying to get it as broad as possible so you can see where those differences really lie. But that snowball technique is very common for Q method to really open that up more, past maybe of what I would think would be open up it, kind of expand that on there, and somewhat hinder me having just a bias.
Since Dr. Passmore is not here, I'll go with it. Yes, so what did you learn through this process about you, about the process, about the world? What did you learn?
Well, I definitely learned that this is not supposed to be my focus. This is an extensive, big, huge project, but it doesn't end here. It needs to continue on. And I learned personally a lot more about different techniques of applying research and how to gather more data. And also I really learned that the networking that I've had through my lifetime really does help you even today, even if I'm not an active practitioner in the field anymore. I need to keep those connections because those practitioners are going to be very important for my teaching, for my scholarly work, for my service, and because if I don't keep those, I might become a little bit more stagnant, and then I'm using the same stories, you know, 20 years from now. And so that networking kind of keeps me refreshed.
Well, if you can help me give Jason a class, we're working very hard on this. And we're going to go ahead and excuse everybody but Jay and his committee. And thank you very much for coming to support today.